Hi everyone, in today's video we're going to talk about the rate of descent. We're going to do a deep analysis of what the rate of descent is, why do you need to control your rate of descent, and then we're going to look and do some very practical examples in the simulator in the approach charts. So without further ado, let's jump right into it. Hi there, my name is Gabriele, I'm a training cap from the Boeing 737. If you are new to the channel, consider subscribe because I'm doing a lot of pilot training content. So if you want to become a better pilot or make your head aviation, this is the right channel for you. Before starting today's topic, please leave in the comment below any questions you may have throughout the video. For me, it's extremely important you get 100% of this topic. Okay, let's start with today's topic, okay, the rate of descent. What it is a rate of descent? The rate of descent is how many feet per minute you lose. So let's say you've got a rate of descent of 1,000 feet per minute. That means that every minute you're going to lose 1,000 feet. So for example, if you're cruising at 10,000 feet and you need to land in an airport that is at 0 feet, so you need to lose 10,000 feet. If you keep a rate of descent of 1,000 feet per minute, it will take you 10 minutes to get the ground, okay, because 10,000 feet, if you every minute you lose in 1,000, it will take 10 minutes to get to the ground, okay. There is an instrument on board in the flight deck that actually tells you constantly what is your rate of descent. This is the variometer, okay. Depending on which aircraft you fly, you've got the analog instrumentation, so like the Cessna 172, where you have like a clock, you've got the physical indicator, the needle, physical needle that goes up and down depending if you're climbing or descend. When the physical indicator is horizontal, that means that you've got 0 feet of climb or descent, thus you're actually doing a level flight. However, if you look on the variometer of a Cessna 172, you will see that has got a 5, a 10, and 5, a 10 on both. That means that if you are descending, the needle will actually go down, okay, the 5 means 500 feet per minute, the 10 means 1,000 feet per minute. Then you've got, sometimes, depending on the variometer, but you've got 100 feet, each for every 100 feet of rate of descent or climb, you have an indication, okay? So you've got like a small white lines that are 100 feet, and then you've got the 5, and then you've got the 10, and then 1500, and so on, okay? So depending on what's your rate of descent, the variometer will actually give you this information in this way. Then you've got the glass cockpit, okay, like the Boeing 737 has got the primary flight display on the right. You've got the information about your vertical speed, okay, your feet per minute. The system works pretty much the same. That means that instead of having a physical indicator, a physical needle that actually goes up and down, you've got a white line, okay, depicted on the screen. The white line, when it's horizontal, means that you're not climbing nor descending. If it goes down, this white line, it means that you're descending. If it goes up, it means you're climbing, okay? Again, you have the indications about how many feet per minute you're climbing or descending, but on top of it, on the glass cockpit, you've got on the bottom of the vertical speed indicator, you've got how many feet per minute you are actually descending, for example, okay? In fact, as you can see, you've got these 550, 600 feet means that you are actually descending with that vertical speed, okay? The way it's structured, this glass cockpit, is to help you out to be very precise of your rate of descent, all right? So, fantastic. But why is it so important to know and manage your rate of descent, okay? So, we have done 2 videos about top of descent, and we talked about the descent management, okay? When you are far away from the runway, it is not a big deal because you can actually change your rate of descent, because if you are high, you can ask for extra track miles and make your route longer in order to lose your altitude. But once you are actually established on final approach, okay, when you have the run in front of you, that is when you really need to get very precise with your rate of descent, okay? The vast majority of the approach procedures has got a 3 degrees descent, okay? So if you jump in the whiteboard, I'll show you what these 3 degrees means. So let's say your runway is here, okay, for example, here we go, that's your runway, okay, and this is your ILS, okay, sorry for the drawing, guys, I know it's not perfect, but what I want to make sure is the concept that's clear, okay. If you're not sure what the ILS is, okay, I will make a separate video about that, but just in very few words, the ILS, you have to imagine like a big corridor that will take you from a certain position on final, let's say 10 miles final, at 3,000 feet, and will actually guide you all the way down to the runway. Okay, so once you get into this corridor that is going down, you will actually be on profile all the time and do a smooth approach into the runway. Okay, The pilot has got you, in this case, will have an indication if you are high or below this this corridor, okay? So in that case, it's quite straightforward to know if your rate of descent is correct, because if you are into the corridor and then suddenly you see that the corridor, the ILS, the glide slope in this case, is actually getting above you, that means that your rate of descent is way too high, okay? The opposite is also true. Let's say you get into the corridor, then suddenly you see that the glide slope or the corridor is actually getting below you, that means that your rate of descent is too shallow, okay? So let me explain what the 3 degrees glide slope is. Okay, if you're looking at the whiteboard here, okay, I draw the glide slope, which is this one, okay, the corridor, let's say, imagine that this is a corridor, and your aircraft gets into this corridor, and it's gonna go down like that until the landing, okay? So, the 3 degrees means that if you draw an horizontal line here, this is the 3 degrees, okay? So, normally, as I said, the glide slopes and the procedures are based on 3 degrees. And 3 degrees is quite good descent because it allows you to descend, to slow down. It's very easy, manageable descent, okay? Sometimes you have approach with 4 and 5 degrees. In that case, it's steeper, okay? Because the angle between the horizon and the glide is steeper, and thus the aircraft will be more difficult to decelerate, okay? Because you're gonna descend with an higher rate of descent, okay? In that case, you need to think about aircraft configurations and so on, okay? But let's talk about the standard 3 degrees descent, okay? Once you get established, as we said, it's so important that you actually know how to stay on the 3 degrees, because you don't want to get too high and you don't want to get too low, because if you get too high, then you can be you can generate energy, because then you need to dive to get back on profile. Diving, the speed will increase, so the energy of the aircraft will actually increase, so you may end up on high energy situation. Or if you get too low, the problem is the terrain, because if you go below your glide slope, you might have a terrain below you, and you might have a GPWS warning, and then you have to do another procedures, okay? So your goal is to stay inside 3 degrees, okay? That is normally the vast majority of procedure has, okay? But how do you know, how can you calculate what rate of descent you need to maintain in order to stay in these 3 degrees? There is a very good rule of thumb that basically, if you take your ground speed, okay, and you multiply it by 5, that's your rate of descent. Because the faster you are on the approach, the higher will be your rate of descent in order to maintain it 3 degrees, okay? Because an aircraft that's flying at 100 knots has to maintain a shallower rate of descent to maintain it 3 degrees. Thus, an aircraft maintaining 200 knots has to maintain a higher rate of descent in order to maintain these 3 degrees, okay? But how do you know? You simply look at your ground speed, okay, and you multiply the ground speed by 5. So let's say you're on final approach, you're established on ALS, and you want to know what the vertical speed, what the feet per minute you need to have in order to stay within 3 degrees, you simply look at your ground speed, you multiply the ground speed by 5, and that's the ground speed you should maintain. So let's say, let's imagine an aircraft that's getting established on the glide slope at 100 knots. In order to maintain it 3 degrees, it has to maintain 500 feet per minute, because 100 multiplied by 5 is actually 500. An aircraft, however, that's approaching, getting established on the glide slope at 200 knots, in order to have the 3 degrees descent, has to maintain 1,000 feet per minute, because 200 multiplied by 5 is actually 1,000. There is another easier way to know how to get this 3 degrees descent angle by looking at your ground speed. If you look at the whiteboard, I will explain how it is, okay? So far we talked about, we said that if you multiply your ground speed, so let's say that your ground speed was in the example before 100 knots, so we said if you take the ground speed and you multiply by 5, so 100 multiplied by 5, this should give you 500 feet, and this is your rate of descent in order to maintain the 3 degrees, okay? But sometimes it's not very straightforward, because if you fly the plane, you're already busy, so there is another way to calculate this a lot easier. So let's say you're flying at 130 knots, okay? Multiply this by 5, now that you're sitting in your chair is fine, but I'll tell you that whenever you're flying, maybe there is bad weather and so on, you want to have spare capacity of your brain to focus on the plane, not to make these calculations, okay? Of course, in a multi-pilot aircraft, you can also ask the pilot monitoring, but an easier way to calculate is if you take your ground speed, okay, in this case was 100 knots, okay, 100 knots, and you divide this ground speed by 2, okay, you're gonna have the vertical speed. So what happened is that if you take with the 100, you divide this by 2, you're gonna have 50. Okay, but 50 is very shallow, so you need to add a 0, and that's gonna give you the feet for minutes. So let's make another example here. If you've got the ground speed of 140 knots, okay, it's a lot easier to divide this by 2 and add a 0, which is 700, okay, because you are adding the 0 in there, and get your feet for minutes, rather than multiply the 140 by 5, okay? I hope you see the thing there, okay? Because then, once you know and how to use this very quick calculation, depending on your speed, because when you are decelerating the plane to get established on final, you actually coming probably with a speed of, depending on the aircraft, of course, but let's say on a Boeing 737, you arrive at 230 knots, then you start to reduce the speed to extend the flap in order to get established on final, then the 230 knots of ground speed will be reduced to 180, for example. And that's from 230 to 180, you need to adjust your vertical speed in order to maintain these 3 degrees. As well as it's true when you are established at the glide slope and you are actually decelerating for the landing flaps, for example, you need to change your vertical speed. So by knowing this procedure, this method, you just look at the ground speed, you divide by 2, you add a 0, and that's your vertical speed that you should maintain. Because let's say you're established on final approach at 200 knots, what's your vertical speed in order to maintain the 3 degrees is 1,000, because you take the 200, you divide by 2 is 100, you add a 0 is 1,000. Then you start to extend the gear, the flaps and so on, and you fly at 160 knots of ground speed. What's your rate? What's your vertical speed in order to maintain the 3 degrees? You take the 160, you divide by 2, and you add a 0. Okay, 160 divided by 2 is 80, plus a 0 is 800 feet per minute. Okay, in this way, you know it. In every single moment, what's your vertical speed to stay on the 3 degrees, okay? This method is extremely useful when you fly a non-precision approach, because the difference between the non-precision approach and precision approach is that with the non-precision approach, you don't have the vertical guidance, so you don't know if your eye or low compared to the correct glide slope, okay? So what you need to do is that once you arrive at a point that you know you need to start the descent, you need to maintain the 3 degrees in this case, okay? And how to do that? Once you have to start the descent from the point that you intercept the final descent, you look at your ground speed and you keep the you do this method and you keep that vertical speed, okay? Let's say you need to maintain 800 feet per minute. If you look, when you look at your vertical speed and you see that you maintain 900 feet per minute, it's better that you come back, because you come back to 750 and then back to 800, okay? You know straight away if you're going below the path, the descent angle, or above the descent angle, depending on your vertical speed, because you know what is the vertical speed that will keep the 3 degrees, okay? So now that you know what the rate of descent is, where you can find the rate of descent, and how can you calculate the rate of descent in order to get 3 degrees, let's jump into the charts, into an approach chart, and I'll show you where to find the information in the approach chart. Look at the whiteboard here. We've got the ILS running 16W. Okay, this is a Jepsen chart. It's out of date, but it's very good for this exercise. Okay, once you know where you can find information about the rate of descent, you will be able to read every rate of descent information in every chart. Okay, what you need to look is this part in here, which is the vertical section of the approach chart. Okay, and as well as in down there there is another table. Okay, if we zoom in a little bit, you will see that the glide slope, okay, in this case this one, okay, will start at this point there, and then it will go all the way down until the runway. Okay, so this one, as we said before, if I make the horizontal line, this is the 3 degrees. Okay, how do I know that it's actually at 3 degrees? Is if you look down here, okay, you've got the 3 degrees in there. Okay, it says ILS glide slope or localizer descent angle 3 degrees. Okay, the vast majority of the approach, as we said, has got 3 degrees descent angle. Okay, then in the table next to it, actually gives you, depending on your ground speed, what vertical speed you should maintain in order to get the 3 degrees. Okay, let's say you are on final approach and you go 160 knots. So the correct vertical speed that you should maintain, okay, as you can see in here, says ground speed in knots. Okay, so if you look in here, these are all the ground speed, depending on your ground speed, 90, 100, 120, 140, 160. Let's say we are flying 160 on final approach. These numbers here are your rate of descent in order to stay on the 3 degrees. And for us, 160 knots is 861. In fact, if we cross-check with a method that we just used a second ago, if we take 160, we divide the 160 by 2, gives us 80. We add a zero, as we said, and that should be around 100 feet per minute. Okay, it's a little bit less, but 61 feet per minute, I can tell you, flying manually is not very easy to maintain. So once you maintain 800, it's very good enough, okay? Because you will not be able as well to maintain it under constant flight manual, okay? So as you've seen, okay, this is a very good method to calculate for every ground speed you've got, what's your rate of descent in order to maintain 3 degrees, okay? So by knowing that, you will be able to fly an operational approach like an ELS almost, okay? Because once you start the descent at the right point and you know your ground speed, you just do this method and then you keep the vertical speed constant and you know you're flying at 3 degrees, okay? Then you will not need any other information. Of course, you need to do other cross-checks such as the distance and the altitude, but if you maintain the vertical speed that is required to keep the 3 degrees, you will be spot on in every altitude check, okay? So I hope you like the video, you took something out of it. If you took something out of it, give it a like and consider subscribing to the channel. Again, leave a comment below with your question and then I will help you out. Also, go to paloclimb.com where you can subscribe for free paro training content. I wish you a great day and I'll see you in the next one.